Hi, my name is Andreas, and I'm here to take you on a 10-minute tour of the worst code I've ever seen. And I promise you all examples have been in production, and I've modified them only for clarity and copyright. We will start small to warm up, and then move on to larger examples. And also, there are some bonus slides. I'll put the slide deck on SlideShare. Let's dig in. We developers know that 1 is much too close to 0 for comfort, so we can't trust Booleans too much. And that means in Java, we have to explicitly check if a Boolean is true or false, or better, double check or double double check. And also, we have to interleave control flows. I don't know why, perhaps to confuse the angry ghost of George Boole. And if we took these lessons to heart, then we can move on to constructs such as this, which show us that Java does not have a feature-rich standard library. For instance, there's definitely no parse Boolean method, and we have to make results extra Boolean. In case you're wondering what the problem with such constructs is, because they work, 99 times you've got this, and 1 time that. Have fun. Seen the difference? The next topic is strings. Strings is one of the most complex topics in computer programming. Fortunately for us, the creators of Java have made a very clever decision. Strings in Java are immutable. However, that doesn't help you if you don't read the documentation. This is an early example of a no-code implementation. In case you don't know, Kelsey Hightower's no-code, check it out, it's fun. This code has no effect because the result of concat is ignored, and concat can have no effect because a header is immutable. So another common error is to create extra string objects. There's no reason because, as I told you, strings are immutable. So this is an example how this could look, or this, or this, or that. That is my favorite because there are 2 string objects in a single line. Take this times 1,000 in your application, and everybody, the only person you're making happy is the garbage collector. This is a little bit more difficult. We are comparing 2 host names or 2 URLs. And I've got a question for you. Which of these are equal? And that very much depends on what you mean by equal. Do you mean they point to the same host, they point to the same adapter on the same host, or do you want a literal string comparison? In most cases, you don't. So this is a very bad idea. The next topic is exception handling. And there are a few classics in there. For instance, the useless catch, or the wrapping of a checked exception and an unchecked exception, so you get the worst of both worlds, or the empty catch. And in this specific instance, I wondered, why is there this semicolon? And then I found the next gem, and I knew. Another classic, the interrupted exception is caught, but there's no action. And the author obviously was of the opinion that he has nothing to do, unless you want to be able to shut your thread down properly. Or catching throwable, and that means you have failed. So that's correct in this regard. And also, in summary, regarding exceptions, some people simply can't be helped. There are tools like SonarQube, which really point out the mistakes you made. If you don't listen, they won't help. One of my favorite topics is security. This is a little bit larger example. This is a HTTP servlet response wrapper. A HTTP servlet response wrapper wraps HTTP servlet response. And there's nothing wrong with that, but both the HTTP servlet response and also the wrapper have a method contract and certain expectations. For instance, if I call set header, I expect something to happen, namely that the headers get set. So that breaks the contract of HTTP servlet response. Why is that an issue? Even if I think my framework works different. In this instance, the HTTP only and secure flags on a cookie header got set using set header, And surprise, no effect. And that caused a real security issue. In this example, you can ignore all the strange code here and only look at these 3 bytes up here. Who knows what these bytes mean? Nobody fluent in ASCII? It's DES, the data encryption standard, which was finally broken in 1997, known to be insecure much earlier. And that DES is represented as bytes can only mean one thing. The author, at this instance was found in a review, and the authors choose to obfuscate instead of fixing it. So this is kind of like sabotage instead of actually programming. And my last category, and also the one I want to spend a little bit time on, I call misover engineering. And this talk is part of my quest to get the word misover engineering into the English language. Misover engineering is not only failing at engineering and not only over engineering, but over engineering so badly that you totally lose your way. And I've got 2 examples for you. The first one is a fairly normal proxy factory that uses proxies to business services, except maybe at this level for these 2 fields, they should have been called delegate and caller. And in the following slides, I'm calling them that because otherwise you wouldn't understand anything. The music is in the invoke method, so we're gonna have a look at what the invoke method does. So, first, if we got no caller, then we create a new Hibernate session. If we have a caller, we use the caller session. And then we begin a transaction, but what is if there already was a transaction? For instance, if we had a caller. Well, then we are no longer isolated and share the transaction of our caller. Bad. So next comes the invoke statement. And then the final processing starts. So if there's no caller, we commit, because if there was a caller, maybe they had their own transaction. So we have a possibly unfinished transaction if there was a caller, because we can't know if the caller does things right. Then comes a very strange path. We start a associated batch process. So there are services that had kind of built-in batch jobs and immediately kill it. What could go wrong? I don't know. Finally, we catch the throwable. And the next thing I'm going to show you is exception handling. We log the error. Then if we have no caller, and the delegate has a transaction, we roll back the caller. Or if we have no caller, if you have a caller and the caller has a transaction, we roll back the caller. And I didn't understand that either. And I have a suspicion what happened. I'm going to show you this on the next slide. Then we rethrow, not the throwable, but the cores. In course of this, we modify the stack trace and possibly also cause a null pointer exception at this point, because cause doesn't have to be set. And finally, we wait for the garbage collector to clean up after us, because we don't close the session, but only set the session reference in the delegate to null. So the effect of this is that the entire application stalls until the garbage collector collects enough sessions that it can move on. The code to close the session has been in there, but has been removed because obviously it's not a good idea to close somebody else's sessions. So in summary, what probably has happened? The program started with a normal 3-tier architecture presentation business integration. The goal was to create a transaction facade in front of the business services. So sometime along the way, the business services started to call each other through the transaction facade, which is a normal thing to do. So, and then obviously the programmers sought some way to correct the transaction facade, which no longer worked. And what you have seen is the result of this. So I don't know why they didn't choose any framework to do this for them. But it happened, and it caused massive issues that that code never worked properly. The last example comes from a massive custom application framework for web applications. In terms of scale, think of JE built in-house at your company. Not a good idea. And specifically, one method caught my attention. It's called reset. And it starts with a list of classes for reset, all in the area of authentication, authorization, legitimation. And in my head, I heard the boss music going off. And this is the rest of the method. What it does is it searches for each class, searches for a reset method, a static reset method on each class, and calls that. Well, how bad can it be? Two instances. In this case, we set LDAP filters for LDAP trees, which are per user. And in the second instance, well, we reset this SSL socket factory for each request. And also, this functionality has been implemented 3 times in the same framework by the same authors. So this was really a great pile of fun, as you can imagine. Also, if you use Reflection, it won't show up in a static code analysis, so your application behaves strangely, and all you can do is debug and hope you stumble upon this. So all that's left is to do is to kill it with fire. And what probably has happened in this instance, that the original programmers perhaps had a C background. So they stored session state and static variables, which is a very bad thing to do. And then they thought, after the functional tests worked, but maybe the load tests didn't because you had parallel users, you need a reset method. But the reset method has to be static because you can't use an interface for a static method. So let's call them by Reflection. And yeah, this code worked functionally, was forgotten for over 10 years in almost 300 applications, which makes for a very, very unhappy Captain Picard. I chose this example because of the massive impact it had. And in conclusion, I have one question for you. What language do you want to have bad code in? There has to be bad code, there has to be legacy, there has to be brownfield. And we are not gonna get rid of that. We can't have good things, we have bad code. So a colleague asked me this question, and I myself was surprised how clear the answer is. There are languages where bad code melts your brain. There are languages like C, where when the code is bad, you really can't do anything. And we have a language here with Java and the great JVM platform that is very maintainable. Thank you.